السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How are you all doing? Did it help you focus? Focus on the recitation? Yeah? Because when we are moving, we're doing one thing or the other with our hands or our eyes are going everywhere, then we're not able to focus on listening. Okay? So if we want to concentrate on something, then first of all, our body has to have khushur. Okay? Khushur is to be humbly submissive when the effect of humility is on the body. So the body becomes still. Once there was a man, he was praying salah and he was, you know, moving his hand, his beard. And the Prophet ﷺ said that if his heart had khushur, then لَخَشَعَتْ جَوَارِحَهُ, then his jawarih, his limbs would also have khushur. So when a person is focusing on something with his mind, then definitely his body will be in tune as well. Inshallah. Okay, let's begin our new subject. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا زدنا علما. Are you familiar with the name of Abdullah ibn Umar? Yeah? Who was he? The son of Umar ibn Khattab رضي الله عنه. So he was also a companion. He was a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was a very young man when he saw the Prophet ﷺ. He was very young when the Prophet ﷺ passed away. And that means that he lived for a very long time after his death. And he was one of those people who noticed things in the Prophet ﷺ that perhaps others did not notice. Because children, they observe things very differently. They notice details that older people tend to neglect. They don't give much importance to. And this is why Ibn Umar radhiyallahu anhu, he was once asked by someone, that I see you doing four things, and I have not seen anyone doing those things. I've only seen you doing these four actions. He said, what are they? He said, I have seen you that when you go around the Kaaba doing tawaf, you don't touch all the corners of the Kaaba, you only touch two corners. And he said, I have seen you that you also put color on your hair or on your turban, and other people don't do that. Likewise, I have seen you that you wear these particular kind of sandals that others don't. And I've also seen you that when you put the ihram for hajj, you put it at the last moment, and other people, they put it on from much before. So Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he explained that I touch only the two corners of the Kaaba because I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam touching only those two corners and not four. So if he touched only those two corners, I will also touch only those two. I put this color on my hair or my turban because that's what I saw the Prophet ﷺ doing. He said, I wear these kind of sandals because that is what I saw the Prophet ﷺ wearing. He was wearing these kind of sandals, so I wear these sandals as well. And I put the ihram right at the end because that is how I saw the Prophet ﷺ doing, that when he would leave for Mina, that is when he would enter the state of ihram. I'm telling you the story because I want you to realize how Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he would follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the Quran, we are not told to wear those particular kind of sandals. In the Quran, we have not been told that when you go around the Kaaba, only touch the two particular corners and not the other two. We have not been told when exactly to put the ihram on, right? But Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he did that because he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam doing it. He did it out of love, he did it out of respect, and he did it as a righteous follower, as an obedient follower. And this is exactly what the subject will be about, ittiba'u sunnah. That is the name of this subject that inshallah we will begin today. Ittiba'u sunnah, following the sunnah, following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The word ittibar is from the root letters ta-ba-ain. And tabi'a means to follow. And ittibar is to completely follow someone. To follow someone exactly, precisely, verbatim. The way they have done something, you do it in the exact same way. Not less, not more, not any different. It's like if you are told that your mother, when she cooked, she put only 1 teaspoon of salt. And if you're a good daughter And you follow her way of cooking, what will you do? 1.5 teaspoons of salt? No, you will put exactly 1. Not less, not more. And if you come up with your own ways, then you're not following the way of your mother. So, ittiba'u sunnah, following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. This is inshallah what the subject will be about. Now we see that amongst the Muslims, typically there are two extremes found. What are those extremes? That some people, they love the Prophet ﷺ a lot. And out of that love, they cross all bounds. They don't consider him to be a human. They consider him to be some supernatural being. They think that he, na'udhu billah, is God, that he deserves our sujood, that like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves sujood, that we pray to him as we pray to Allah, right? So these kind of beliefs and practices that are common amongst many Muslims. But the same Muslims, they love him, but they don't know how to follow him. They don't follow his ways. If you ask them about the sunnah, the practices of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they don't know much. Or they don't do much, even if they do know. They don't act much, but they might be aware of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did, what his habits were, but they think it's okay for them to not follow him. And the only thing that's necessary for them to do is to show, to express their love by ways that may even be inappropriate. Whether it is by killing others, or it is by, you know, singing songs of praise and adoration, celebrating his birthday, whatever it may be. But this is a common thing that is found amongst the Muslims. And we see that on the other hand, there is another extreme, which is that people belittle the way, the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ. They say, why do we have to follow another human being? So what if he ate with his right hand? I feel comfortable eating with my left. So what if he, when he stepped into the washroom, he stepped with his left foot in first? Why do I have to do that? It's more convenient for me to step in with the right foot, right? So there are other people who go to the other extreme, that they fall short in giving due respect to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. They do not give much importance. But we see that there has to be a balance between love and obedience. Rather, the balance is the combination of love and obedience. That a person has love for the Prophet ﷺ, but at the same time he also obeys and follows his ways. Because what is love without obedience? If you tell your husband, I love you, and he says, please iron my clothes for me. He says, no, do it yourself. That's not love. That's not true love. That's just fake. That's just talk. Right? What is true love? A combination of both love and obedience. And when it comes to loving someone truly, wholeheartedly, then obedience is easy. You don't have to think twice. It comes naturally. You naturally tend to obey the person whom you love. You naturally tend to follow them without even them asking you for something. This is just like if your mother asks you to bring her a cup of tea, right? And you know that she likes to have tea in a particular cup. Will you ask her, should I bring you tea in that cup or any cup? No. Or will you just bring tea in any cup? No. If you truly love her, you will give importance to her preferences. Correct? You will not have a problem bringing tea for her, and when you do bring it, you will bring it in her favorite cup. Even if it was dirty, you will hand wash it. You won't wait for it to go in the dishwasher and come out clean the next morning. No. You'll hand wash it. You'll dry it, and then you'll bring her tea in that cup. It's not difficult then. So love and obedience, they come together. Love is genuine when there is obedience, and obedience is genuine when there is love. So this subject we are going to study. Why? Because after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are we to love and obey? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we cannot truly love him and obey him unless and until we find out about the importance of loving him and obeying him. And how, in what ways are we to follow him? So after the Qur'an, the next important thing is what? The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the reason why this subject is being taught to you at the very beginning of your course. When you haven't even completed one juz, alhamdulillah, the subject has already been introduced. Okay? Chapter number 1, An-Niyyah. An-Niyyah is the intention. Can anyone guess what the root letters are? Noon, Waw, Ya. Niyya. What is niyya? Intention. From the root letters nun waw ya is the word nawat. And nawat means the seed or the pit of a fruit. For example, you eat a date. And in the middle, what do you find in the center? The seed. You have a mango. And what do you find in the center? The seed. The pit, right? You have a peach. What do you find in the middle? The seed. The pit. Now, if you put that seed or that pit in the ground, what's going to happen? If you put it at the right time, in the right type of soil, what's going to happen? It will grow. Is the seed visible? Once it's in the ground, is it visible? No. Where is it? It's under the ground. It is hidden. But it is there. Correct? And does the seed have an effect on the type of plant that will grow? Will it? Yes. If you put a date seed, what will come out? What will come out? A date plant, right? If you put a mango seed, what will come out? A mango plant. So depending on the kind of seed will be the plant that grows out of it. Correct? So niyya, the intention, is what is buried where? In the heart. It is hidden. It's not visible. But its effects are where? On the actions. If the intention will be there, then the action will also come. And depending on how the intention is, the action will be. Now, right at the beginning of this book, there's a whole chapter dedicated to intention. And you will find this in many, many books. For example, if you open Sahih al-Bukhari, right at the beginning, Imam Bukhari mentions the hadith about intentions. Many other fiqh books, you will open them, and this is the first thing that you will find. Why? Because just as the seed is the foundation, if you don't have a seed, you won't have the plant. To start the process of growing a plant, what do you have to put in first? The seed. Likewise, when we are studying, whatever we are studying, whether it is hadith or it is about the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, anything that we are studying, the foundation is what? Intention. In fact, anything that you do in your life, what is the foundation of that? The intention, the reason why you're doing it. Correct? So, at the beginning of the book, we are reminded to correct our intentions. To correct our intentions. That whatever we are going to do, we do it for the right reason, for the right purpose. And what should that reason and purpose be? What should it be? To earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That if we are studying this, we are studying this. Why? Because we want to better ourselves. So that we can attain the pleasure of Allah. We are studying this so that we can strengthen the knowledge that we have of the deen so that we can actually serve the deen. Right? We can defend the deen. We can live the deen. So the intention is critical. It is very, very important. This is why it's clarified right at the beginning. So the intention. Precept 1. Intention is the basis of reward for deeds. Intention is the basis of reward for deeds. The author, he is proving this point. And in this book, and in many other books that you will study in this course, inshallah, you will study books that are authored by Iqbal Khilani. Okay, these books were originally in Urdu, and they were translated from Urdu into English. And you will see that the style of this book is such that, you know, paragraphs and paragraphs have not been written. Okay, basically the author is proving certain things with the help of texts from the Qur'an and Sunnah. So he will mention a statement, and then he will provide evidences supporting it. From where? From the Qur'an and from the Sunnah. So this is why it's very important for you to attend the class. Because if you miss the class, what's going to happen? You won't be able to figure out what's being mentioned here. Okay? What's being explained over here? What's being proven over here? So the first thing that he mentions is that the intention is the basis of reward for deeds. Correct intention? Great reward. Corrupt intention? No reward. عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال, he said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو إلى امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. رواه البخاري. Let me translate it for you. عن. What does عن mean? From. Meaning this has been narrated on the authority of who? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. So he is a sahabi. قال. He said, meaning Umar radiyallahu anhu said, that سمعتُ. سمعتُ. What do you think it means? I heard, because سمعَ, right? So سمعتُ, I heard رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Does this need to be translated? No. يقولُ, he says, meaning I heard him saying. What was the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying? That إنما, indeed not but, الأعمال, the actions. What's the singular? عمل. بالنيات, with the intentions. النيات, plural of نية. What's the root? نون واو, yeah, good. So indeed, actions are according to the intentions. وإنما, and indeed not but, لكل, for every امرئ, person, for every person is ما, that which, Nawa, he intended. So every person will get what he intends. Faman, so whoever, كانت, it was, hijratuhu, his hijra, his migration. Ila to dunya, world, meaning some worldly benefit. Yusibuha, he attains it. Aw, or, ila to imra'atin, a woman. Yankihuha, he marries her. So he migrates, he does the hijrah. Why? To get some worldly benefit. Or he migrates from one place to the other. Why? So that he can marry someone. Fahijratuhu, so his hijrah, his migration will be ila to ma, that which hajara, he migrated ilayhi, to it. In other words, his hijrah will be to that which he wanted. So his reward will be based on his intention. He migrated to get some worldly benefit. He will get only that. He won't get reward for doing hijrah in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. Likewise, he migrated to just marry someone. So when he gets there, okay, he'll get the reward of marrying whomever he wanted to marry. Will he get hasanat? Will he get reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making that shift from one place to the other? No. Which kind of hijrah is acceptable to Allah? The hijrah that a person does for the sake of Allah, to earn the pleasure of Allah. That, oh Allah, I am leaving my house. I am leaving my place. And I am moving from here to another place. Why? Because I want to please you. Whether it is to seek knowledge, or it is to, you know, benefit someone, or it is to practice the deen more easily, whatever the reason may be. Okay? But the ultimate reason is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, let's read the running translation of this hadith. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu narrated that I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, deeds depend upon the intentions. Every person will get the reward according to his intention. One who has migrated for worldly gain will get it, meaning he will get the world. One who has migrated to marry a woman, then his immigration will be for what he immigrated for, meaning he will just get the woman and no reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does this hadith show to us? That any action that we do, any action, it has some intention, some reason behind it. Whether it is the action of eating, or it is the action of talking to someone, or it is the action of buying a particular thing, or it is the action of taking a particular class, or it is the action of seeking knowledge, praying salah, reciting the Quran, wearing the hijab, whatever a person does, there is some reason behind it. Isn't it? For example, you go somewhere. Why? Because your mother wants you to go. What's your intention? To make your mother happy. Okay, that's your intention. Okay. You put on some clothes because you feel that everyone's going to like them. And you're going to get a lot of compliments. And you're going to stand out. And you're going to look good. And you're going to fit in. Okay, that's the reason. Or that you want to show to someone that, look, I have these clothes as well. Okay. So what's the intention? What's the intention? Show off. Okay. A person is buying something. Okay. They don't really need it, or even if they need it, But they're buying it. Why? To show that, look, I have this much money, I can even afford this. Or that I don't have a problem spending this much money. What's the intention? Showing off again. A person is eating something. He's eating so that he can have the energy for the rest of the day, so that he can work better, he can be productive. So what's the intention? What's the intention? To be productive, to be useful, to be beneficial, to have something achieved at the end of the day, so that he can actually please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we see that the reason why a person does something is his intention. The reason why he does something is his intention. The purpose behind it. The reason that is in the heart of the person. Okay? This could be good, and it could also be bad. When is it good? Okay, when it's for Allah. But if you think about it, when you are, for example, eating, right? So that you can have energy, so that you can have a healthy body, you take care of what goes into your mouth. That feeling is not that conscious in your mind that I'm doing it to please Allah. Is it? Every time you eat, is that what you feel? No. But if you ever ask yourself that why am I eating healthy? Why am I eating nutritious food? What's the answer that you have? So that I can be a healthy person, so that I can make something of my life. So then ultimately it is for the sake of Allah. So remember that the good intention that you have for Allah, sometimes it is very clear in your head that you're doing it for Allah. And sometimes it's not that clear in your head. But in either case, inshallah, it is accepted. In either case, it is good. Because a believer, whenever he does something good, his ultimate goal is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other kind of intention is what? Bad. For example, showing off. An intention to disobey Allah. That a person deliberately, you know, leaves their salah, doesn't pray. That you answer back to someone because like, yeah, you know what? I'm going to say this really harsh statement to them so that they feel bad about themselves. So pride that a person wants to show to the other that, look, I'm so great. That's the intention, to show one's greatness to others. Any immediate gain. So for example, a person gives a gift to someone, but what's the intention? I'll get something back too. They're not doing it for Allah. They're doing it to get something back. So which deeds, which intentions are acceptable? Which intentions matter, are useful, beneficial? The good ones, right? Ultimately, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And which intentions ruin a person, destroy a person, waste his life? Which ones? The bad ones. Because no matter what great of an action a person may be doing on the outward, if the intention is corrupt, that for example a person is reciting Quran to show that, oh look, I can recite so well. That's the intention, to show off, to impress other people. Then no matter what great of an action on the outward it is, because the intention is corrupt, what's going to happen? That action is useless. So over here, as we begin the study of this book, we need to ask ourselves, why are we doing what we are doing? Is it just to satisfy some person? Or is it to gain knowledge so that we can prove to others that we are very knowledgeable? Or is it to better ourselves, to improve ourselves, to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to serve the deen, to benefit the deen? What is the intention? Next hadith. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم وأموالكم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم رواه مسلم. What does this mean? رواه البخاري رواه المسلم. Rawahu, from riwayah. Riwayah, narration. Rawa, he narrated. Who narrated this hadith? Muslim. Meaning he recorded this hadith in his collection. The previous hadith was taken from where? Sahih al-Bukhari. This hadith has been taken from where? The Sahih of Muslim. Okay? Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed Allah does not look at your faces or your wealth, but He looks at your hearts and your deeds. Inna, indeed, Allah, Allah, la, not yanzuru, He looks, nazar. Right? So indeed Allah does not look at ila suwarikum, ila to suwarikum, your faces or your appearances, suwar, plural of surah. Not surah with the scene. That's a chapter of the Quran. This is surah. The appearance, the shape, the form, the face of a person. Wa amwalikum. Or your wealth. And your wealth, meaning he does not look at your faces, nor does he look at your wealth. Amwal is a plural of mal. Walakin, but yanzuru, he looks at ila qulubikum, to your hearts, wa a'malikum, and your actions. Qulub is a plural of qalb, and a'mal plural of amal. Allah looks at your hearts and your actions. What do you look at? Yes, anything that comes before your eyes. That's understood. But let's say there is a, you go to somebody's house. Okay? You walk into their house. What will you look at? Everything and anything? Huh? Whatever you find interesting. Okay? Whatever you find important, whatever you feel is important. For example, you love artwork. As soon as you walk into their house, they take you into their guest room, and you're sitting over there. Obviously, your eyes will notice the artwork on the walls. Right? If you're not that interested in artwork, you won't even notice it. Correct? This is just like children. When they go somewhere and they love candy or they love chocolate, they will notice that before they notice the carrots and the celeries on the table. Isn't it? What you love, what you like, what you find is important, you will look at it. And what do you turn your eyes away from? From something that you don't like, something that you don't bother too much about, something that's not that important to you, something that you don't feel is that valuable, that important, then you don't even bother looking at it. For example, if something does not belong to you, okay, it's somebody else's, and it's sitting on a desk, will you bother to look at it, to take care of it, to look after it? No. You're like, whatever, it belongs to somebody else. Your jacket is there, somebody else's jacket is there. What jacket will you look at and be attentive about and be careful about? Yours, because it matters to you, right? Likewise, you buy something, for example, you buy a phone, and it comes in a very lavish packing, okay, very detailed packaging. What will you do? Keep staring at the box. Oh my God, how many corners is it? No, you're just going to open it up, throw away the wrapping, and you're going to get to the phone. Because that is what is important. So in this hadith we see, what is it that Allah gives importance to? And what is it that He does not give importance to? Two things Allah does not give importance to. What are they? Your appearance and your wealth. And there are two other things that Allah gives a lot of importance to. And what is that? Your heart and your actions. Why doesn't Allah give importance to our appearance? Our wealth? Why not? Because He gave it to us in the first place. He's not in need of it. He doesn't want us to give Him anything in return, like give Him any wealth or any money or anything like that. Allah is Al-Razzaq, the provider. Right? So when He gave us what we have, He's not interested in the things that we have. Okay? What He wants to see, to look at, is our actions. What do we do? Okay? Another reason why Allah does not look at our wealth, our appearance, is because eventually what's going to happen to our appearance? Our bodies will age. They will deteriorate. Our beauty will disappear. Eventually our body will be put underground. And eventually it will disintegrate. Eventually it will turn into dust. And on the Day of Judgment, we will be resurrected. And on the Day of Judgment, the bodies will be recreated. So, this body is not of much importance, in other words. It's going to go away. Likewise, our wealth. What happens to that? Either it will break, or we will lose it, or it will become outdated, right? Or it will become spoiled, or it will end up in the junkyard, or it will be inherited by somebody else. Something or the other will happen. And eventually the Day of Judgment will come when everything that's on the earth is going to finish. كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ إِذَا دُكَّتِ الْأَرْضُ دَكَّنْ دَكَّ. When the earth will be powdered and crumbled, crushed. So what does your crystal matter? You know, what does your scratch-proof screen of your phone or your iPad matter? It doesn't matter. Allah gave it to you in the first place, and eventually these things are going to go away. وَمَا بِكُمْ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever ni'mah, whatever blessing you have is from who? Allah. He gave it to you in the first place. Right? Likewise, Our bodies, who made them?
Allah.
يخلقكم في بطون أمهاتكم. He creates you in the wombs of your mothers. He made us. Right? وخلقكم أطوارا. He created you in stages. So, eventually the body, the appearance, the beauty, as well as the wealth, no matter how much, no matter how precious, no matter how valuable it is, eventually it will finish. What will last? What will remain? What remains? The deeds that have been recorded. The deeds that have been secured. They will remain forever. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. What remains are the good deeds. So Allah does not look at our forms or our wealth, but what does He look at? Our hearts and our actions. Why does He look at the heart? Because in the heart is the intention. So with what intention are we doing something? Why does He look at the actions? Because that is what we have produced. That is what matters. So ultimately, what we need to focus on is what? Just gaining more money? Just beautifying our skin, our appearances? No. Our main focus should be on what? On our actions, on the state of our heart. Just as we focus on our physical cleanliness, we don't want even one, you know, deficiency in our body or one thing that could make us feel embarrassed before people. We keep checking mirrors. And I've seen people, you know, they keep looking at their phone, you know, checking, is their hijab perfectly fine? Is their face fine? Are their teeth okay? Is their nose okay? Is their eye makeup fine? Is it smudged from anywhere? They're constantly looking, constantly checking. Whereas it doesn't really matter. Allah doesn't get impressed by your beauty. You want to please Allah, you have to do some good deeds, and you have to do them with the right intention. So this action that we're about to do, of studying about the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, this should be done how? With the right intention, so that it is acceptable to Allah. That, oh Allah, yes, I want to learn about the sunnah, so that I can follow it too. I can be one of those people whom you love. And our actions, that whatever we learn, should not just remain in these binders, in our notes, but that it comes into practice, so that we have something to show on the Day of Judgment. Because this binder, this notebook, these sheets, what will happen to them eventually? What will happen? They're not going to be useful for very long. What's going to matter is what? What you gain out of it and put into practice. You know these juz that you have right now? You're writing your notes in them. Such perfect, beautiful notes, right? After a few years, you will wonder, what do I do with these juz? I'm done with the course. I've taken all my tests. What should I do with these juz? Some people, they shred them. Others, they keep them, right? But what matters most? What you have learnt and put into practice. So this book also, whatever we are learning, we need to put it into practice, inshallah. Let's move on. Chapter number 2, Ta'rif al-Sunnah. The definition of Sunnah. Ta'rif, Ayn Rafa. What does the word Sunnah mean? Precept number 2. The literary meaning or the linguistic meaning of the word Sunnah is the way or the path, whether good or bad. This is the literal linguistic meaning of the word as-sunnah. What does it mean? The way, the path, whether it is good or bad, doesn't matter. Okay? That's the literal meaning of the word. What's the evidence for that? This hadith. عن أبي جحيفة رضي الله عنه قال, he said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ومن سن سنة سيئة فعمل بها بعده كان عليه وزره ومثل أوزارهم من غير أن ينقص من أوزارهم شيئا رواه ابن ماجه. Abu Juhayfa رضي الله عنه, he narrated that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من هو سنة, سنة, he set an example, he began a practice, of سنة, a practice, a way, فَعُمِلَ بِهَا, so it was acted upon, بَعْدَهُ, after him, كَانَ لَهُ, it will be for him, أَجْرُهُ, its reward. Meaning, whoever started doing something good, he will have the reward for doing that good deed. وَمِثْلُ أُجُورِهِمْ, and equivalent to their rewards, whose rewards? Of those who followed him. Okay? Because he initiated a good practice. Okay? After him, people continued that practice. So this person will get the reward for what he did, but because others kept doing that good deed even after he was gone, he will get their reward as well. He will get their reward as well. Min ghairi, from other than, meaning without, an that yanqusa, it reduces, min ujurihim, from their rewards, shay'an, anything at all. Meaning those who followed that good practice afterwards, they will also keep their reward. It doesn't mean that their reward will be transferred to the one who initiated the practice. No, both will get the reward. Okay? Waman, and whoever, sunnatan, whoever initiated a practice, sayyi'atan, that was evil, fa'umila biha ba'dahu, and it was practiced, it was done after him, kana alayhi wizruhu. It will be on him, what? Wizruhu, its burden, meaning the burden of sin will be on him. Why? For having done that bad action. وَمِثْلُ أَوْزَارِهِمْ, and equivalent to their burdens. Of whose burdens? Those who followed him in that bad action. مِنْ غَيْرِ, without أَنْ يَنْقُصَ مِنْ أَوْزَارِهِمْ شَيْئًا, without their burdens being reduced in the least. Running translation, whoever starts a good act, and after him it was acted upon, meaning it was followed, then for him will be his reward and the reward of all those who followed him in that act, without diminishing from their reward. And a person who starts a bad act, and it was acted upon after him, then for him will be his burden and the burdens of all those who followed him in that act, without diminishing anything from their burdens. Ibn Majah, this is also a collection of hadith narrations. So this hadith was taken from there. So in this hadith, you see that the word sunnah has been used. Two words have been used. Sunnatan, hasanatan, and sunnatan, sayyi'atan. And what do these words mean in the text? Practice, way, path, right? Sunnatan, hasanatan, a good way, a good practice. Can you think of some good practice that someone initiated and after him it was done? Adam alayhi salam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him and he blew the ruh into him, it started coming into his body, head down. When it reached his nose, he sneezed and he said, Alhamdulillah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, Yarhamukallah. So till today, whoever says Alhamdulillah upon sneezing, who gets the reward for it? You get the reward for it, for saying it, but who else gets reward for it? Adam alayhi salam. You get your reward. That's, inshallah, secure. But because Adam alayhi salam was the first one to do it, he will get the reward of every single person who ever says Alhamdulillah upon sneezing. Good practice. He initiated it. Sunnatan sayyi'atan, evil practice. Any example? Someone initiated it? The first murder. The first murder. Qabil, he killed his brother. Right? So, he is the first one to kill a human being. So, after him, whoever kills, whoever murders, that murderer, yes, he will get the sin of his committing that evil deed, but the first person who initiated that evil practice will also get that sin. So, this hadith is being mentioned over here to prove that the word sunnah means, what does it mean? A way or a path, okay, a course, a practice, a manner of doing something, okay. And we see this word appearing in the Quran as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Sunnatullahi. This is the way of Allah. It's mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 62. This is the way of Allah, meaning this is the way that Allah deals with people. This is what Allah does when people do such. وَلَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تبديلا. And you will never find for the sunnah of Allah any changing. Meaning this is exactly how Allah deals with people who behave in this certain way. It is also said that the word sunnah, from the root, seen nun nun, are derivatives, which mean that when things go very smoothly, like water flowing in a creek. Just imagine a small stream and water is flowing in that. Is it continuously flowing? Is it? Yes. Is it flowing smoothly, easily? Yes, it is. So sunnah is called sunnah. Why? Because there's repetition, right? There's continuous action. The Prophet ﷺ, he repeatedly perform certain actions. For instance, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wearing those particular sandals. So he repeated that action many times to the point that Ibn Umar noticed that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ate with his right hand to the point that other people noticed that. Right? So this is the reason why it's called sunnah. And it's also repeated after him. Isn't it so? He did it many times and after he's gone, still it is being repeated again and again. All of us eat with the right hand. That's what we're supposed to do. Drink with the right hand and not the left. Because that is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And when something flows smoothly, easily, what does that mean then? How does that relate to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? That when you follow it, your life will become easy. People think that if they follow sunnah, things will become too difficult for them, burdensome. Oh, I have to eat with my right hand. Oh, I have to step in with my right foot in first. I have to put the right sleeve on first. People think that it's difficult, but in reality, their life becomes easy. You know why? Because when a person follows the way of the Prophet ﷺ, then there are two benefits. A, Allah will love him. And when Allah will love him, Allah will help him. So life will become easy. Okay? And B, everything that the Prophet ﷺ did was the best way of doing it. For example, when he prayed, he performed salah in the best way. When he made dua in the best way. You open any masnoon dua. Can you ever come up with a dua that's like that? Never. You know, we think, what should I say? How should I make dua? What words should I use? We just sit there, just contemplating. Words don't flow out of our mouth sometimes. But when you read the masnoon dua, you're like, this is exactly what I wanted. This is exactly what I wanted to say. So whatever he did, however he did, whatever he said was the best. So this is how your life becomes smooth. This is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Precept number 3. In Islamic law, meaning in the Sharia, the word sunnah means the way of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ. So technically, when you refer to the word sunnah, you're not just talking about anyone's way. You say, oh, this is my sunnah, that when I eat with my left hand. No, it's my own sunnah. No. When you talk about sunnah, in the Islamic sense, it refers to the way, the manners of who? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني رواه البخاري. أنس بن مالك, he narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said فمن, so whoever, رغب, he turned away عن, from سنتي, my way, فليس مني, then he is not from me, he does not belong to me. Anas ibn Malik narrated that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever turns away from my sunnah does not belong to me. Now in this hadith, the word sunnah refers to what? The way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An Talhah ibn Abdullah ibn Auf qala, he said, sallaytu khalfa ibn Abbas ala janazatin faqara bi Fatihah al-kitab qala liya'lamu annaha sunnah. Talha ibn Abdullah ibn Auf, he said, that sallaytu, I performed salah, khalfa, behind, ibn Abbas, ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, ala janazatin, on a janazah, meaning, I performed the funeral prayer behind who? Ibn Abbas. So in other words, Ibn Abbas was leading the funeral prayer. Faqara'a, and in the funeral prayer, he recited, bifatihat al-kitab, the opening of the book, meaning he recited Surah Al-Fatiha in Salatul Janazah. And afterwards, qala, he said, liya'lamu, I recited Surah Al-Fatiha in Salatul Janazah. Why? Liya'lamu, so that the people know, annaha, that indeed it, sunnatun. It is a sunnah. What is a sunnah? To recite Surah Al-Fatiha in Salatul Janazah, in the funeral prayer. So we see that, in the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, the word sunnah was used for what? His ways. And according to the understanding of the companions as well, the word sunnah was used for what? The way of the Prophet ﷺ. His manners. his practice. Now, when it comes to the ways of the Prophet ﷺ, the actions, the practice, in precept number 4, we learn that there are 3 types of sunnah. Okay? When it comes to his manners, there are 3 types. When it comes to his sunnah, there are 3 types. First of all, as-sunnatul qawliya. As-sunnatul qawliya. What does that mean? The sunnah that has to do with the qawl of the Prophet ﷺ. So in other words, the sayings, the statements of the Prophet. So the first is as-sunnatul qawliya. The sayings, the statements of the Prophet ﷺ. As-sunnatul fi'liya. The second kind is as-sunnatul fi'liya. The deeds and the actions of the Prophet ﷺ. And the third kind is as-sunnatul taqririya. What does that mean? The approvals of the Prophet ﷺ. What are they? Let's look at them one by one. The first is as-sunnatul qawliya. So, precept number 5, the sayings of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, they are referred to as as-sunnatul qawliya. Here is an example. عن حذيفة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الشيطان يستحل الطعام ألا يذكر اسم الله عليه رواه مسلم. He said that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, indeed the shaytan يستحل, he considers permissible, meaning he enjoys. When you consider something permissible, you do it. Right? So he considers permissible for himself what? Al-ta'ama, the food, which food? The one that, and la, on which not, yudhkara, it was not mentioned, ismullahi alayhi. The name of Allah was not mentioned upon it. So in this hadith, we see a statement, wordings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A statement that he said. From this statement, what do we learn about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That before he ate, what would he say? Bismillah. Because he said, if you don't say Bismillah, then shaitan will consider that food permissible and he will eat out of it. So from this statement, you learn about the statement of the Prophet ﷺ of saying Bismillah before eating. Precept number 6. Any deed of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ is referred to as as-sunnatul fi'liyya. Here is an example. عن نعمان بن بشير رضي الله عنه قال he said كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يسوي صفوفنا إذا قمنا للصلاة فإذا استوينا كبر رواه أبو داود. نعمان بن بشير he said that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم يسوي he would straighten صفوفنا our rows إذا قمنا when we would stand للصلاة for the prayer. فَإِذَا so when إِسْتَوَيْنَا we were straightened, meaning our rows would become straight, كَبَّرَ then he would say the takbir. So in this hadith we learn about the action of the Prophet ﷺ. Which action? That before leading the prayer, he would make sure that the rows are straight. That everyone is standing shoulder to shoulder, foot to foot, no person is standing, you know, in front of the other person standing next to him. No, straight rows. This was his action. So from this hadith we learn about an amal, an action of the Prophet ﷺ. Precept number 7, the approvals, the tacit approvals of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ are referred to as as-sunnatu taqririyya. Here is an example that عن قيس بن عمر قال, he said, رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا يصلي بعد صلاة الصبح ركعتين. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلاة الصبح ركعتان. فقال الرجل إني لم أكن صليت الركعتين اللتين قبلهما فصليتهما الآن. فسكت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. رواه أبو داود. قيس بن عمر he said, رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he saw. So رأى, he saw. Who saw? رسول الله, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم saw. رجلا, a man, يصلي, he was praying, بعد, after, صلاة الصبح. The morning prayer. Which one is that? The Fajr prayer. What was he praying, that man? He was praying ركعتين, 2 rak'ahs. So after performing the Fajr, he was performing 2 more rak'ah. فقال, so he said, who said? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that salatu, the prayer of as-subhi, the morning, are just raka'atan, they're just two raka'as. And we have already prayed those two raka'as in congregation. So what are you praying now? فَقَالَ الرَّجُلُ, so the man replied, إِنِّي, indeed I, لَمْ أَكُن, لَمْ not, أَكُن, I was, meaning I did not, صَلَّيْتُ, I did not pray, الرَّكَعَتَيْنِ, the two raka'as, اللَّتَيْنِ, those two which, قَبْلَهُمَا, before them two, meaning before the fard, the two sunnah, I did not get a chance to pray them. فَصَلَّيْتُهُمَا الْآنَ, so now I have prayed them too. Now, after the fard, I am praying the sunnah, because I didn't get a chance to pray them before. So, فَسَكَتَ, so he was silent. Who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And his silence meant approval, that it's okay. It's okay for you to do that. Because technically the rule is that when salah has been established, when it has begun, then there is no other prayer except for that. إِذَا أُقِيمَتُ الصَّلَىٰ فَلَا صَلَاةَ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةِ. So for example, you go to the masjid, and the imam has already said Allahu Akbar. And you say, oh, I didn't get a chance to pray my sunnah. Then what do? You pray your sunnah and then join the jama'ah? No, you're going to join the jama'ah immediately. But because you missed it before, now after the salam, what are you going to do? You're going to say afterwards. So in this hadith, we see the Prophet ﷺ did not say to anyone that if you miss your sunnah before the fard, then you say them after. He didn't say that. Did he do it himself? Did he do it himself? No, he didn't do it himself either. But what happened here? He approved when somebody else did it. So this is also a sunnah. So in summary, what do we learn? That the sunnah is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It includes his words, his actions, and his approvals. Okay? His words, his actions, and his approvals. There's a final note at the end that all these sunnahs are equal and have a legal status in the Sharia. What does it mean? That all these three types of sunnah are considered the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So for example, if a person does something that the Prophet ﷺ did, is he following the sunnah? Yes. If he is doing something that the Prophet ﷺ instructed, is he following the sunnah? Yes. If he is doing something that he approved of, is he following the sunnah? Yes. Will it be acceptable? Yes. There are levels, which inshallah I will tell you in our next class, that which one is greater in rank. Okay? Is it the words, is it the actions, or is it the approvals? Okay? Now, I want to give you some homework. Can I give you? Can I? Okay. If you open the first chapter, chapter number one, the intention, the second hadith, is it short? Yeah? Okay, I want you to practice reading it in your group time. Can you say it? Can you do it, inshallah, in group time? And when you're saying it, remember, these were the words that the Prophet ﷺ said. So you want to say them too. Inshallah. We'll end over here. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.